6 years ago, I saw a small job ad in a newspaper. It had such a typical picture of a design car, and it talked on rapid prototyping. And to be honest, it looked a little bit boring, a little bit technological. But as there weren't too many jobs for graduates at that moment in time, I decided to apply. And it's funny to see that those small things can have such a nice impact on a life. Because I rolled into the world of an awesome technology, which is called 3D printing. And tonight, I'm going to tell you about the impact that this technology can have. The impact on product design, the impact design on the impact on entrepreneurship, and even the impact it could have on our society. The six following years, I worked at a company here in Leuven, which you probably all know, Materialize. First, I worked on the software side, but soon after, I was a member of the founding team of iMaterialize. And iMaterialize is a product platform which allows creatives, designers, everyone who would like to test the technology to produce 3D printed parts or products. And so much has changed in these 6 years. Because in the beginning, I remember it was all there for experts and companies, while now, everyone who wants to play with it has accessibility. As the technology was evolving, at the end of last year, I co-founded a startup, which is called Twikit. With Twikit, we produce or we design creation apps that allow everyone to tweak products, to make unique products. So that's the next step towards the accessibility again of this technology. But what is really innovative about this concept is that we purely rely on digital production technologies to make what we sell. And if you think on that, that is pretty innovative, that is pretty cool, because we don't need inventory, we don't need huge investments on beforehand to make thousands of products and then to start testing if they actually sell. And I think if I can give a factor, maybe a factor can decrease with an amount of 10 in the investment you need in starting up a company. And that is a very nice thing. And it was in the same period when we were starting up and working hard that there appeared a book on Amazon. And it was called Makers. It's written by Chris Anderson, which you might also know from the bestsellers like The Long Tail, for example. How does Chris Anderson define a maker? A maker for him is someone who uses digital creation tools to create stuff and then uses digital production technologies to produce it all. And they also tend to work online. Why do they work online? Because it's a very direct sales channel and an easy sales channel towards a market. And it's also a way to collaborate with other people very easily. And as soon as we read that, we felt very confirmed. We had something like, hey, that's exactly what we are doing. And indeed, that's the fact that there, worldwide there is a maker movement really going on. And if you think of making on itself, that is not so new, because from the very start of humanity, people have always used the tools that were available to produce the inventions they made. And many of these products were very simple, but really pushed us forward. Think, for example, the wheel, or think the first stones that were used. And some of these inventions were really more radical. They really changed how society worked. Think, for example, the spinning wheel combined with steam power, or think more recently, personal computers along with online, the world that connects us all. And then you could ask yourself, why has there been so few hardware innovation in the last decades compared to software innovation? Well, I think one of the most important reason is that a software guy has all the tools available in his hands to do it himself. He writes his code, which is actually designing, and as soon as he's happy, he commits it, and he can put it online, and he immediately see how the market is reacting. And if the market reacts well, then he can start selling. While with hardware, it's much more difficult. You need to make an invention, and then you need to produce it at a feasible price. And then comes the most difficult step, which is marketizing it. You need to find people who are willing to pay for your product, and you need to set up a whole system to reach them. And that needs a lot of resources. That needs a lot of power. So what happened? Only big companies were able to do this. And I think that is one of the most important things of democratization of 3D printing. Everyone who has an idea now can take these tools, and he can go to the market himself, and that will really boost innovation. And he can make products for himself or you can make products for very small markets. And these small markets were not interesting for companies before because they want big markets. They want to sell huge amounts. And they can, most importantly, also make products that didn't exist. So innovation and product development will go way faster. Will everything be 3D printed in the next coming years? Because you read a lot of press and you would think that it's there and in 2 years everything will happen with this technology. No, I don't think so. And I hear three topics a lot of time that I would like to share with you. The first thing that is very important is size. And I remember at Materialize a couple of years ago, there was a rule that said that your product needed to be inside the size of a golf ball in order to be able to sell it in a feasible way. So I mean a commercially viable way in the market, and that you could still let your company grow. But already now, we are at the size of a tennis ball, or maybe even a little bit bigger. So if you already think and look around which product of you would fit in the size of that tennis ball, that's already quite some opportunity. And the most important thing is the evolution, because if in those 3 years so much happened, then maybe in the next 3 years we are at the size of a football and more things can happen and we have more materials. Another thing that you hear a lot is the price. Yes, it's true. If you put a mass-produced part next to a 3D printed part, the 3D printed part will be more expensive, but that is wrong to do so, because I think if parts or products are expensive to make, then you should also sell them expensively. And that sounds a little bit easy, but I mean you need to find for the right markets where you can really use the value of this technology. And the technology has a couple of values that you can use. For example, you have a design value. You can make very complex things or things that look different. And that's the reason that in the jewelry market there is happening so many 3D printing and so many testing, because you can do really different things. Another really important value is customization value. If you have the tools or the systems available, you can sell products at an amount of one at a feasible price, very specifically for one person. And that's a huge, huge opportunity again in different markets. Another important thing is customer involvement. Combined with the online world and the flexibility of the technology, you can now work together online. You can collaborate with different people to make something, and that can either be a bunch of people who have the same interest, or that can either be a company that works together with these companies, with its customers, to increase the bond. So I do hope that on the next invention you have, or the next creative idea, that you take a look at this technology, because it might not only be your chance to set something up, a small company, it's also just fun to make things. Thank you very much.